And good morning to Honourable Premier Nema Ntombela and my colleague here, good sister, MEC Mansentiu. Indeed, Premier, I can attest that you've got a very dedicated soldier on the ground. Even the officials in our department, I'm with the acting DG there, Dr. Nicholas Crisp, who's been managing the vaccination. And so he knows that Matthew, whenever there's a shortage of vaccines, she won't even wait for the officials. She would be the one to pick up the phone and call him and say, Doctor, where is the vaccine? We are short of Pfizer, we are short of Johnson & Johnson. I know even when we're doing the educators, you know, she would call me and say, Deputy Minister, we got many teachers here, and you can't send them away because some of them were not on the EVDS, because especially those who came from private. So I can say indeed, I'm very grateful in terms of the partnership from the National Department with the MEC and the officials from your province. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the media as well. We are indeed very happy today, this morning, to be here in the Free State. Our presence here, Premier and MEC and other colleagues, is really to come and acknowledge the good work which you are doing, your leadership, and also to thank the health workers and the whole of government and the whole of society for the very good cooperation which we are having in this fight against COVID-19. And we are here to reinforce your efforts. And I must thank the MEC and the team for the memorial for the fallen heroes, our health workers who fell in the front line in the Universitas Hospital and other health facilities in Mangaung and also in the province as a whole. We are indeed, Premier, making progress. You are correct to say that this is a marathon. I've said this many times. All of us, when we started, we thought we were facing just an immediate threat. You know, we always do face disasters. I mean, in the health sector, we have dealt with many disasters before. Some of you may have forgotten already the listeriosis, the Polony disease. I mean, it came, it was dealt with, it's gone. Some time ago, I think when I just come into the health department, there was also some threat about Ebola. Ebola is coming. Everybody was scared of Ebola. We're running around making sure. And then, what? Ebola never even arrived. And it was gone, and we could go back to normal. We get outbreaks, you know, of various diseases, you know, the waterborne diseases, typhoid, and so on. And then we are done with it. And then sometimes natural disasters, floods, we run around, and then it's over. And when this problem of COVID started and arrived in South Africa, we also expected the same thing, that it will be a fight, lockdown, and then it will be over. And then where are we now? We just a little bit below 2 years, just 1.5 years from last year, March. I remember, Premier, when I came here, I think it must have been in February. Yeah. And at that time, this disease was some disease in China. And I came here to come and discuss the possibility of the students, and many of you have forgotten, our students were in Wuhan, in China. And I came to meet with the Premier and the team to try and negotiate and brief them about the possible reception area in one of the hotels for those students. It was like something very far. And all that people were still worried about, hey, it mustn't come here. And then here we are. So indeed, it's been a long battle, but we have learned a lot. But we have made progress. We're making progress in the fight to contain the disease. But also, we are now making progress in preventing it from flaring up more and more in the future. That is the main purpose today. We are containing the disease. As you know, that we want to, the infections, as you said, is now even affecting younger people. So we're doing everything together to make sure that we can reduce that, reduce the deaths, reduce the hospitalization and people as, ending up in ICU. Now, it's thanks to the efforts of all of you and the leadership, the health workers and the leaders of society, members of society generally, for the progress which we are making. Because I will indicate, even in this third wave, which has been very long, I mean, compared to our first wave, which took about 80-something days, second wave, 95 or so, we are now possibly approaching 120 days of the third wave. But there is a light at the end of the tunnel. As of yesterday, our overall infection rates, new cases, as compared to the last 7 days, we are down by 35% in this third wave. 35% from when you look at the figures of yesterday, when you look at 7 days before. Hospitalization is down by 12.5%, so overall in the country. So good progress. The positivity rate, the number of specimen which test positive, it's also down by 9.5%. In fact, the positivity, I mean, is now down to 9.3% positive. In fact, yesterday's positivity rate was just 9%. A few days ago, we even reached 8%. So we're getting closer to where the WHO says you are now stable, if you can get down to a positive rate of only 5%. So we are slowly getting there. Active cases are also down by 2.5%. The Western Cape, Eastern Cape, and KwaZulu-Natal remain still the highest numbers, but they're also getting down. But those are the coastal provinces. For the last 3 to 4 weeks are the ones which have been leading. They are still leading, but the numbers at least are going down. And we believe that it is all because of the working together, because of the cooperation of all of us. And that's why on Sunday, you remember that in the family meeting, the president was able to announce relaxation of a number of restrictions, which will allow more social activities, more people in the for gatherings, from 50 maximum to 250. So 5 times more people in the indoors and 500 outdoors. It's because of the fact that, as I've shown, the numbers have been improving, going down. So we're able to regain some of the economic and also social activities. Now, if we continue, ladies and gentlemen, and all members of our communities, if we continue to comply with the personal health and safety measures, more relaxations will be on our way. We are going to assess, we will be reporting to the National Coronavirus Council in 2 weeks. And if there is continue to be good cooperation and good progress, we will get even more relaxation. Instead of 11 o'clock curfew, we might then go to midnight and we might get even more numbers of activity. And for those who are worried, especially in the alcohol business, we've given you one more day of Friday to can buy your stuff. And if you behave, if we all behave, you will get back even Saturday. But it's all going to depend on how well we are working. Now, we are happy also, Premier, that the Free State is also showing improvement. Mm-hmm. But we think we can do better, MEC. We can do more. Your province, as you said, is neighboring, especially you've got the twin, which is called Northern Cape. Mm-hmm. And together, yourself and the Northern Cape, you are still struggling in terms of really bringing the numbers down. Mm. You're not too high, but you're not very low as we would want to do. At the present moment, for instance, as of yesterday, you were number 4. I mentioned KZN, Western Cape, and Eastern Cape. In terms of the positive cases, you were 12% of the total of yesterday, for instance, which was number 4 in the number of cases in the country. Now, for a province of your size to get 12% of the national, I think is too high. So we will be discussing later just to see how we can work together to make sure that we can bring down the numbers so that your hospitals also should not be under pressure anymore. Now, the second part of our battle, as the Premier also touched on, and which is also a major reason why we're here, it's of course the rollout of the vaccinations. On that side, Honorable Premier, MEC, and other dignitaries and members of the media, we are indeed also making a lot of progress in terms of the vaccination. We are not exactly at the target which we want, as we're discussing also around the experiences here. We've got big capacity, we're not yet using the maximum capacity. As of yesterday, by the close of the vaccination time, we had done 220,450 new doses of vaccination. Now, that is still lower than the 300,000 which we wish to reach, which the president said we must. We have not yet touched that. At the best, I think we reached up to 270, 280. So we still have a lot of work to do. To that, of the yesterday's numbers, the Free State contributed 14,880 yesterday. Now, I think the target for set for you by the Premier is, what is it, 15,000? You're not far from there. I think you must be more ambitious. Mm. Well, 15,000, especially if it's more of the new cases, new vaccinations, new people, I think it will be a good target because the figures here include those who are coming for the second dose. Mm. So 15,000 of completely new people who are coming for vaccination will be very good. So we are still satisfied that people are coming forward, but we wish we can do better. In terms of the total doses thus far administered, we have passed 15.5 million of doses. As of yesterday, we're at 15,683,000. So quite some progress. In terms of individuals who have at least have a jab, we have now passed 11 million individuals in the country. We are standing now, as of last night, at 11,200,000. So we are currently at 28% of the adult population, of those who are above 18. We want to reach 70% before Christmas. So we still have a lot of work to do. At 28%, we hope that we can still reach another 17 million, which will take us to 70. Now, in this case, the Free State is number four. I don't know why you like this number four. You are number four in terms of the infections which are still happening per day, but you are also number four in terms of the coverage of the total adult, which is good this time. This time is good because as a province, you have covered 30% of your adult population. Mm. The average national, we're sitting at 28%. You are at least 2% above the average at 30% of the coverage of the adult population. But you can do better. I'm afraid to say your other neighbor, the Western Cape, is running away from you, in this case at 36%. So 6% above you. Western Cape is sitting at 36% coverage of the adult population, followed by the other neighbor that side, the Eastern Cape, at 33% of the adult population covered. And my province, Limpopo, is sitting at 32% of the adult. But I must also hasten to add that in terms of the over 60s, Limpopo is leading, has already passed 70% of the adult of the 60s, over 60. So if we can all reach that 70% of Limpopo, I know you are sitting at about 60 something. Mm. So you can reach that 70% of the 60s. And the Eastern Cape is leading in terms of the over 50s, sitting at about 65% of the over 50s in the Eastern Cape. So I'm giving you this figure so that you must be ambitious, put more pressure, Premier, and get the people out there to mobilize, you know, encourage the over 50s especially, and the over 60s, because that's really the risk when we get to towards December with a possible, let me not even say possible, we almost, from the experience we know, there will be a fourth wave. So the question is, what do we do before it comes? Now, in terms of people who are fully vaccinated, that is either one dose of the J&J or two doses of the Pfizer, we're sitting at 7.7 million individuals who are fully vaccinated, just a little under 20% in terms of people who are fully vaccinated. So we still have a long way to go, but I'm very encouraged that slowly but surely we get in there. So as I've mentioned, we still need at least 16 to 17 million more people to come forward. If that happens, I can tell you that we will have a very good Christmas if we can at least get closer to that minimum 60%. At 60%, it means that we still have to get about 12 million, but we are more ambitious to say 70%, which says we must get another 16 to 17 million more people. But, and we are happy, Honorable Premier, and I'm sure even here in the Free State, nationally we're seeing that more influential people, celebrities, football legends and players, musicians, and many other influential people in the society are now coming forward to endorse and participate in the vaccination. We want to again repeat to say this is really important for all of us as individuals to make sure that when the virus comes to us, we get less serious illness, less risk of ending up in the hospital, even less risk of ending up in the ICU, and even lesser risk of succumbing to the virus if we are vaccinated. So this is really the message which we want to repeat. Now, through if we really ramp up the vaccination, many of us take it, we are almost certain that we can reclaim a lot of the kind of life we are all missing. We're all missing getting together with the family, with the friends, birthday parties, you know, nice weddings and so on. We're all, you know, really very thirsty for those kind of activities. And if we indeed take the vaccine, many of us, all of us, we can get more social activity and even more important, more economic activity, more restaurants, hotels, and many of these activities, including even the sports and the culture, the music, festivals. I mean, all this can actually, you know, they're not only good for our social and emotional and spiritual lives. We can get more into the churches. I mean, it's a sad situation, and we appreciate the fact that so much has been sacrificed. I mean, all in all provinces, we know how many of us who are religious are missing those big gatherings. I mean, the Easter. I mean, if you look at the big church like the ZCC church with big Easter activities, and I know that even here in the Free State, we've got big churches which have big Easter functions which have not happened for 2 years. Now, part of the results of this is that we're starting to see more and more mental health problems. You know, even younger people, there were reports a few weeks ago, which show that a lot of anxiety, even amongst young people, a lot of depression. We're starting to see rising suicide because people are depressed. You know, they can't do the things which they like to do. So we're saying, let us all take this opportunity of taking a vaccine, because we can really end up with very good improvement in the quality of life. We can go back to, you know, to the stadium. I'm not so, let me not venture into your football situation, because I don't know where is Punya Selesele now. But it's there. I mean, its status, I'm not sure. But, you know, you can get back to the stadiums, you know, to the rugby, the cheetahs and all that. And Premier, you can get Makufe back. Yes. If people are going to get the vaccine, Makufe can be back in full force. So we're not talking theory, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of the life can be claimed back. I'm sure all of us who watch TV, sports, I mean, when you see in England and other parts of Europe, full stadiums, and you wonder, is this in the real world? It is in the real world. It's because they've passed 60%, 70% of the vaccination. So we can claim our lives back if we can just do the small thing. Just walk into the site, you know, get a jab, and then that's it. You're contributing towards getting the life back. Now, that's why, ladies and gentlemen, we also talk about, I know, difficult topic of a vaccination certificate, also called a vaccination passport. I want to explain that the aim here is not to punish anybody. The aim of this vaccination certificate is not really to punish anybody, but is to protect each other. The aim is to make sure that these things which I'm explaining, that you can have some proof, and they can be. We can then come with a policy which encourages that people who are vaccinated can access a lot more other amenities in bigger numbers, and there can be a proof that indeed you have been vaccinated, and therefore that you are protecting yourself and you are protecting others. Now, our team, led by acting DG, Dr. Nicholas Crisp, at the back there, it's working very hard to make sure that we can present the preparedness of this vaccination certificate to the National Coronavirus Council. In the next 10 days, they will be ready to present and to the NCCC the implementation plan for this vaccination certificate. And we hope that once that is done, we can then, you know, roll it out, work with. We won't be able to do it alone as health. We will need the assistance of Home Affairs, other departments, sports and recreation, so that we can then make this available and that it can be used to make sure that we can have even more activity. Now, I want to emphasize that this certificate will not prevent people from accessing essential services, especially public services. You will not be required to show a certificate to get to the clinic. I've had some people who want to rubbish this, to say we're going to deny people. He says, no, that's not going to happen. Essential services like health, social services, your pension, all that, education, this is not meant for that. What it is meant for is to say that you can open up more economic, recreational activities, as I've mentioned, your big activities, religious activities, in bigger numbers and bigger participation. That is what we want to make possible. Of course, we know that some of the employers are already looking at this to also make some regulations. That will not be because government will come with a policy which says that you can't access a particular job if you don't have a certificate. That is something which, you know, if it's done with some private people in their restaurants, in their hotels, in their salons, there might be some salons which says no certificate, no hair, no what do you call this thing, no weave, no vaccination, no weave. There will be some salons which will come with such regulations, but it will not be because it's a government rule. That government will provide the facility, but it's only for activities which are for leisure, for recreation, and of course we leave the rest to private organizations and private bodies. So that's really what it will be meant for. Now, The last point which I just want to touch on, because I know it's also been talked about, we'll be aware that our current approach is to vaccinate adults. Mm-hmm. Now, we are aware that there's also a problem which already we've been, the Premier has touched on, where we're starting to see a lot of infections amongst younger people. Now, some of the vaccines, for instance, Pfizer, has already been approved by SAHPRA for even below 18. You might have seen that Sinovac last week started trials also for below 18 years of age. Now, so Pfizer is already approved. Sinovac, which is also approved for emergency use, is also working on testing for below 18 years of age. Now, in terms of our approach at this stage, even though we know that the Pfizer has been approved, we want to remain focused for now, for the next month or two or whatever. We'll discuss with our colleagues in the provinces, our National Health Council, when do we review this. As of now, we want to remain focused, you know, on the high risk, which is the older people, 18 years and over. And even there, that's why I'm happy with the way they've arranged the queues for the vaccination, where you have the over 50s and then the below 50. Our main priority still remains 50 plus, because that's where, if we can reach 70% of the 50 plus, even if we can be at 30-40% with the younger people, we know when the next wave comes, our hospitals will not be as overwhelmed as it has been. So we are aware of the pressure also on schools. The Premier and the MEC and the team were telling us about the boarding schools and so on. At this stage, it's not that we are ignoring that, but we want to remain focused with a very high risk, which is the older people. So for now, we are not ignoring the signs of the fact that some vaccines have been now been proven to be safe, but we want to push to cover the high risk. And then once we at least reach, hopefully 50%, 60% of the high risk, we're hoping that somewhere by the end of October, by the time we are done also with the elections, we see how, whether there's been super spreader or not, by that time we will have covered a lot. Then we can keep on reviewing. Somewhere down the line, as also our stock of the vaccine improves, we might be able sooner rather than later to also go to the below 18 because of the fact that the vaccines are now approved. But we think it will be very risky to be all over and start just running around everywhere. Let's try and manage the schools, keep them safe and so on. Keep on pushing for the older people to be vaccinated. Once we have made good progress, we are now approaching 30%. I'm hoping that at least by end of October, we could be close to 50%. When we reach that, we might be in a better position to actually say, can we now consider the children below 18? So I thought we should just make that point so that there shouldn't be a lot of anxiety. We are conscious of the fact, we are aware of it, we are planning for it. We just want to make sure when you go that route of the 12 to 17, then we are sure that we have done a lot, we have covered a lot of the older people. So as I conclude, I want to say that indeed, congratulate the province in terms of the magnificent work containing the infections, making sure that our hospitals, as much as they are under pressure, are not overwhelmed. And also thank to especially our health workers for keeping up that good work of saving lives, and call upon to our people in general to say, we can defeat this COVID if we work together. We can actually have a much better end of the year, festive season, if we all work together. We can reduce the pressure on the health services, on our health workers. All that we have to do as citizens is to just walk. These days, most of the time, you don't even have to drive because the pop-ups are coming in the taxi ranks everywhere. Please just encourage your neighbor, your friend, just to walk to the nearest vaccination center. Even if you are not registered, you can see even here, there are people who are waiting. If you are not registered, they register you. So I want to thank you, and indeed, I hope that you know, we'll all work together to keep up the good work, and if we continue that, we can be able to save our nation. I want to say, all of us, as we get ready to go and vote on the 1st of November, remember that it's better to vaccinate before you vote. The two V's go together. Vaccinate before you vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, for encouraging update to hear that in terms of the numbers of infections and the numbers of hospitalizations are going down. It shows that indeed the people are getting our message and they are responding. And we believe that we hope that if people can keep it up like this, surely, as you said, we'll have a good Christmas. And all of us are looking forward to have a good Christmas. Without wasting any time, I'm going to allow the MEC of health to give us
the words of questions first.
Oh, yeah, so sorry. Yeah, no, before I allow the MEC, we are going to allow the members of the media to raise the questions so that we'll be able to interact and try for all the questions. I'm going to take up the questions now. First question will be the first one. Second one. Any other hand? We'll take up these hands for now. If people want to make the follow-ups, we'll feel free to. Tell us who you are, your name, and the media that are presenting, then post your question.
Thank you so much, Minister. It's Aphumelele Mzalane from SABC News. You have clarified the issue of the certificate, but on the ground, there's still a reluctance, there's still hesitance. And with this issue of now being a debate about higher institutions wanting to, intending to make vaccination mandatory, we did the story about that, and I saw how vocal way student unions where they were saying that students shouldn't be compelled to take vaccination, however they're supposed to be encouraged. How far are we now in terms of addressing this issue, making sure that people understand that it's not mandatory, even the certificate doesn't mean that you won't be going to the essential services that you did mention, but in terms of communicating that aspect, where are we? And here in the Free State, there's been complaints about the sites, especially in your small towns, in vast areas where elderly people are unable to go to vaccination sites, however they are willing to vaccinate, but because of the transportation and lack of sites thereof, how is that issue being addressed? Thank you so much.
Okay, next.
Manuva from ENCA. First of all, Minister, I'm just looking at your target 30% of the year in terms of vaccination. You said that you're hoping to vaccinate about 70% of the population by the end of the year. But in reality, we've only left 3 months. So are you still confident that you're going to reach the target in terms of vaccination? Mm-hmm. And just secondly, there have been reports that the Ministerial Advisory Committee on COVID-19 is actually discussing the possibility of making vaccines mandatory for several specific groups of people, which include healthcare workers. Is that the fact?
Tumaulin, sorry, from Newsroom Africa. My question is about the youth. What messaging and what campaigns are you planning to try and get young people to stay away from social media and other unreliable sources of information when it comes to COVID-19?
Okay. Any last questions before we respond? Okay, in the absence of more questions, I'm going to allow our principals to respond. But I believe that, as Minister said, that we are supported by our technical colleagues, the HOD, DG, and other technical colleagues will be assisting to respond to some of the questions. Minister?
Let me address the questions that were directly to the province. about the complaints of the size of the elderly. Mm. We actually received that complaint, and it was in smaller town of Tweespruit. But what we are doing right now, we are embarking on the pop-up sites, especially in those smaller areas, ensuring that we go closer to where the people are, apart from the fact that we are trying to get the younger generations in car washes and even in the taxi rides during the weekend. But what we do now, we are going closer to where the people are. We are moving out of our permanent sites and ensuring that we go to where the people are, so that you do not have to board a taxi to get to a vaccination site, but you get it closer to where you are staying. With the hope of the 70%, we are actually saying if we our target of 15%, which the minister is saying is not really enough.
15,000.
Yeah, I mean 15,000. If we do 15,000 per day, and per week we get 75,000, we are definitely going to achieve our goal of 70% by December. That's how we have calculated. We will do that. Because we have seen that now people are not coming. We have changed the strategy. We don't wait for people to come to us. We go to them. I started in Kwakwa working with my people where we were in the shopping mall. During month end, when many people are coming for their shoppings, there was a vaccination site closer to the shops. When people come to do their errands in town, they're able to get a vaccination. But even during the week, our people, our vaccinators, like I said, they've got the pop-up sites that they're creating in all the townships. So we definitely are going to make sure that we work towards making sure that every week we've got more than 75,000 people that we have vaccinated. Then we would be able to get to 70% as Free State. The messaging that I think we are trying with our own communicators within the department to also get into that space of or social media to also give the positive messages around the issues of the vaccination, because we're talking about something that has been proven through science that the vaccination works. Before we vaccinated our own healthcare workers, most of them were getting infected and they were demising. But after we vaccinated that lot, very few of them are getting hospitalized or even getting sick to an extent that they even demise. Then we vaccinated the second lot, which was the teachers. Every week in the Free State, you'd hear about the death of a teacher. But after we vaccinated them, they're not dying anymore. So those messages are the messages that we have requested our communicators to take those messages out into the social media to counter the negative that the youth is purporting that vaccines are dangerous and all that. Just this morning, we are saying we're also encouraging the pregnant women, our youth that are pregnant, to get vaccinated. Because if they do not, and unfortunately they get infected, right now we've seen them getting severe illnesses and they demise if they don't have, they haven't been vaccinated. Just yesterday, we lost two ladies that are pregnant in universities due to them being pregnant they had been infected with the COVID-19. So we're encouraging even the pregnant young women to get vaccinated.
Thank you very much, MEC. Thanks.
Premier.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have just discussed, we have 316 vaccination centers. And we have planned that we are going to turn all our clinics in the province to become permanent vaccinating centers, because all our clinics were not permanent vaccinating centers, but all of them, our clinics are going to be vaccinating centers now. In order for us to reach our target of 1.9, we must remember that is not the responsibility of the minister alone. All of us in the Free State, we must make sure that we reach the target of 1.9. It means all of us, we must work hard to encourage our people in the Free State to make sure that they vaccinate, so that we must reach that target of 1.9. So it is everybody's business to make sure that we educate our people, we encourage our youth to go and get they must be vaccinated to get their jab, by the way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Premier. That's 1.9 million. Eh?
Yes. Out of 2.9 population.
Okay.
We are about 800 now.
Well, no, 1.9 premium is the total population of adults. So I think in terms of your 70% will be maybe about 1.5 somewhere there. So you're
not bad.
Yeah, you still have a million to cover. You are now sitting just under 600,000. It might have gone up. It's 700. Oh, okay. Okay. So, Dr. Crisp there and his team must update the numbers. You must reconcile.
People versus vaccinations.
How much?
The difference between individuals and vaccinations.
Oh, I see. Oh, you mean the jabs which have been given, that will be. Okay. So in terms of the jabs already administered will be about 700 to 800,
yeah.
But the actual individuals, just under 600,000. So which is that's why you are in the top four.
Mm.
If it was a football league, you'd be called the top four out of the nine provinces. So. You're getting there, Premier. We just have to work together to do more. The issue of the higher education, as I've mentioned, I've said that from a government point of view, we want to make available the certificate and make sure that it has good protection and that it is reliable information derived from your electronic vaccination data system. When your certificate says you have had one jab of Pfizer, it must be real. When you update on your phone, the certificate will upgrade you to say two jabs.
Mm.
So when you come to Free State Stadium, when they say, let's see your certificate, you open your phone. Last week it was one jab, today is two jabs.
Mm.
So it will show on your certificate. That's really just to make you access all these services. Now, we are saying that independent institutions, we're not going to get into the policy of independent institutions. You must remember that higher education institutions have their own governance. They've got their councils, their senates.
Mm.
I was listening on the radio, was it yesterday, I think, or the day before, they were discussing about University of Cape Town. And they were indicating that this is a discussion in the university, it's a debate, it's going to the Senate of the university must discuss whether it's going to be compulsory. From the Senate, it's going to go to the University Council. Council of a university is the governing body of the university. It's like the municipality. It's like the municipality of Mangaung with the mayor. So the chairman of council is like the mayor of UCT. So they are going to discuss at the council, university council, and they will make, that's the body which makes policy for that university. It affects only, that policy when they make it only affects them. Now remember, the university also, higher education has got even its own legislation. There's an act on higher education, and some of the universities even have their own acts which establishes those. So they've got their own governing structure. So when they make a decision, it's not because they will be instructed by, that's why they are consulting.
Mm.
They are consulting students, they are consulting staff, they are consulting Senate and so on. Then they will make a decision. It might not be a decision which is supported by 100%, very unlikely. In there are very few institutions, if any, where even if there's consultation, when the policy is finalized, you can say that everybody is supporting it. So I want to emphasize that, therefore, there is nothing wrong with UCT, University of Free State, University of Limpopo, MTN, Discovery. These are private institutions. We provide the platform and say, here is the document, here is a system if you want to know. If it is in your interest to know whether, you can even use it. Somebody was saying to me, once you do that certificate, nobody will come to my house without a certificate. If my child has got a birthday party, I'm going to ask, who is coming? Do they have a certificate? No certificate, no entrance to my child's party. So individuals are going to make even decisions for their families. And this person was saying, my relatives, I've told them, no certificate, when this thing comes, you don't come and visit me. You must, you know, so you, we are not going to interfere with those decisions. Whether it's a university, whether it's a household, whether it's a football club, whether it's SAFA, whether it's PSL, whether it's Cricket South Africa, whoever makes that decision, we will provide the facility to say, here it is. So I want to just clarify, therefore, that don't get confused with that situation. Don't get confused with that situation. I think it just also to indicate that to cater for everybody, it will not only be on your smartphone, you'll be able even to print it. For those who don't have facilities for smartphone, once the certificate is available, you can go to the nearest site where there is vaccination. If they have got printing facilities, they can even print. When you are vaccinating for the first time, once this thing is working, if you indicate after your jab that, hey, I need the certificate, our vaccination sites will make it possible for you to can actually have it printed. If they don't have a printer, they will have to refer you somewhere and make sure that you can get, so that not only those who have got smartphones. So, but policy-wise, I want to just emphasize that the universities and any other institution will be free to make internal policy. Football, cricket, anybody who runs a music festival will be free to. We will provide policy in terms of saying, if you have a function with all the social distancing, if you are strictly hosting only vaccinated people, for example, we are now at 250 undercover. I mean, under the roof, in house, in the house, inside. And 500 outside. Once these things become available, we may then liberalize it to say, if everybody is vaccinated, you can go up to 400 or 500. If your space allows a meter or 1.5 meter distance, you can increase to 1,000. If you are strictly going to get only vaccinated people. If you are not checking vaccination, please keep it to half. I'm just giving you an example. Those are the things we'll be working on, so that people can get the benefit. Even the people who run facilities can then get the benefit that you can have a bigger music festival if you've got strictly only vaccinated people. If you don't want that, you are free to do that, but do smaller numbers because the risk will be higher. So those are the kind of things, but you'll also be able to get it on the print. I think the MEC has dealt with the issue of local. Now, the issue of 70% by the end of this year, that is really our target. It remains our target. We're going to do everything to encourage people. But remember that we, as government, as civil society, leaders, traditional, we're talking to everybody, encouraging everybody to come on board so that we can all claim our lives back. But the bottom line remains, we are, as a government, as a state, we are not going to venture into anywhere to say, and that answers the question about the Ministerial Advisory Committee advising on mandatory vaccination. We are not foreseeing any time in the near future, as a state, as a government, saying that it's going to be compulsory for citizens. And that's why I mentioned that we are not getting into a space where we can start saying you can't get health, you can't get this public services if you are not vaccinated. We're not getting there. So because of the fact that we are relying on persuasion, And coming to Maule, in terms of the message, again, we depend on yourselves also, as we are depending on yourselves as the media to continue to help.
All right, so let's now cut out of that media briefing by the Health Minister, Dr. Joe Pan.